Hello, this is Bob Harris here on BBC Radio 2 with an amazing lineup of artists today as we relive highlights from Series 5 of the award-winning television music show, The Old Grey Whistle Test. Brian May will be joining us to reminisce about Queen's fantastic 1975 Christmas special. Series 5 of the programme began on the 30th of September that year, running every week through to the 25th of May 1976. The show was beginning to feature more and more live concert specials, most of them coming from the BBC Theatre on Shepherd's Bush Green, nowadays known as the Shepherd's Bush Empire. But not all of the concerts came from the TV theatre. The programme was increasingly taking camera crews out and broadcasting live from the major venues. But for one of the absolute whistle test highlights, you go to the Queen Christmas Special, broadcast live from the Hammersmith Odeon on Christmas Eve, the 24th of December, 1975.
We're presenting a night at the opera. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Queen.
Just a little section from Now I'm Here. That was Queen on stage at Hammersmith Odeon. That was our Christmas special, and Brian May is here to reminisce about that moment, because the first time I saw you, I think, was at the Rainbow Theatre a couple of years or so before that, Brian, and you were playing that night supporting Mott the Hoople.
Well, the Rainbow concert was ours, but the previous time we were at Hammersmith was supporting Mott the Hoople. Yeah, that's the time.
That's the one.
Yeah. But that was our first visit to Hammersmith Odeon, as it was called, of course. I don't know what the hell they call it now. It's always going to be Hammersmith Odeon to me.
me too.
We supported Mott the Hoople there, and then we did our own Rainbow show, but coming back to Hammersmith as headlining that thing.
Yeah. But Now I'm Here was a song written by you about the Mott the Hoople tour experience, really, wasn't it?
It was indeed, and about rock and roll in general, and the fact that it blew my mind. And I didn't even take the drugs. So there you go.
Down in the city, just Hoople and me.
Exactly.
But that Christmas special that we did together in December 75, Brian, I mean, the great atmosphere around the band at that time as well, because I was privy, wasn't I, to some of the filming later of some of the videos that you did and everything else. And
absolutely.
The thing that really struck me, Brian, so forcibly was the extent to which the band, you cared about your fans and you looked after your fans.
Well, that's a very nice thing to say. Yes, we did, and we felt very fortunate to have the kind of fan base that we had, if you can even call it fan base, because they were very intelligent and they didn't require us to fit into any mould, for which we were always grateful, because we continually evolved and had all different kinds of shapes, really, didn't we, as a band? But the fans were always there. There's the occasional grumble, you know, what are they doing now? But basically, they followed us and they enabled us to go on an amazing journey without any frontiers whatsoever. So we're always very, very happy with our fans. And, of course, there came a moment a little bit after that when the fans kind of took over, because when it got to, I'm thinking Bingley Hall some years later, when the audience was singing every song and a few others besides, and we really clocked onto the fact that our audience were part of us and that a show was a two-way experience, not just a one-way experience. It's funny, now this reminds me, so we wrote We Are the Champions and We Will Rock You and that sort of stuff, and really purposely involved the audience in a participative kind of way. But that brings me back to Hammersmith in a sense, because I remember one of my first impressions is we'd got the idea of doing a show and it was very dramatic, you know, and I think we were sort of pacemakers in a sense, you know, sort of leaders in that field, because when Queen started, it was very much let's all play with our backs to the audience and groove with the vibe, man, and let's not, you know, doing a show was a bit uncool, but we went out there and said, no, we will do a show, you know, we'll have sound and lights and we will make absolute maximum, we'll take absolute advantage of the situation because we're only there for 2 hours. Let's give them everything. Let's deafen them and blind them and leave them wanting more. You know, so we were very much into a show. So normally we were lit very, very well. We had, you know, not huge lights in those days, but we had some lights. And the audience was always in blackness. And I remember coming onto the stage for the Hammersmith thing, and of course all the house lights were on and all the TV lights and whatever, and we stood there waiting for you to do your announcement, just seeing all our audience, which was a really strange experience. Also, we couldn't speak. You know, we were waiting for you to do the announcement, so we just came on there and stood there, and there was a moment of eyes meeting, this contact between us and the audience in a completely different way from what we'd been used to. Normally, we come on in a cloud of smoke and big bang and whatever, and, you know, as I say, deafen them and blind them. But this was a very different experience, and it was a strangely sort of liberating experience because we felt, as soon as the lights went down after you'd made your announcement, we were back to our normal sort of world, but we'd already made that eye contact with the audience. So it was a very intimate kind of feeling for that show.
And at that moment, you were the wave now that you'd begun to surf on. At the time of that concert, Bohemian Rhapsody had just gone to number one, and at the start of that massive... A Night at the Opera was released, I think, either on the day or a couple of days later. And that went straight to number one. So in a way, that concert, that moment, represented the transition, wasn't it, into the absolute sort of top of the premiership, really?
Yeah, I think it did. I think we were a bit shocked that we'd been chosen to do that at that point. You know, it was a sort of privilege to be the sort of TV attraction for that Christmas. And, you know, we didn't take it for granted. It was a big deal for us. And, of course, it got you out of Christmas, which is the wonderful thing, because you always wonder what to do at Christmas, don't you? You know, who do I go to? Oh, God, I'm going to upset someone. We were just there, and we had to work on that show, which was a joy. We had a place to be.
You did, didn't you? Because, actually, you'd put Christmas on hold for a few days.
That's right.
Because it didn't actually follow on as the date tagged on to the end of the tour. There was a little gap, wasn't there, between the tour dates you've been doing and then that show at the Hammersmith Odeon.
That's right.
So, you know, you'd had a lot of time to think about it.
Yeah, we set it up as a separate thing and we rehearsed as became the habit for us. I mean, we actually... rather keen on the idea of rehearsal. You know, we like to improvise, we like to step out and be dangerous, but there's nothing like rehearsal to set you on the right rails. You know, you have to know what you're doing to be dangerous, you know.
Yeah,
you've missed out the very first time we met, of course, which I'm going to have to remind you of. No, we didn't meet, but the first contact was you playing Keep Yourself Alive on the Old Grey Whistle Test, and we didn't know you. You were some star that we thought we'd never be able to meet, and you played diddle-diddling, diddle-diddling, and there's a little train running along and all those wonderful old movie images, and that was the first time we ever got exposed on TV.
Do you know the story of that?
Tell me.
Well, because Mike Appleton, the you know, the program producer, somebody had left a white label on his desk, but it wasn't labeled in any way. There weren't, you know, nobody had written on the labels. We didn't know what it was. And he put it on the record player, and of course, we loved it. He passed it over to Philip Jenkinson, who matched that cartoon. And isn't it amazing, Brian, the extent to which indelibly printed in one's mind are some of those combinations of music and film?
Absolutely.
And that was one of them, because that cartoon was like the runaway train, wasn't it?
It was, never to be forgotten. By any of us, but you gave us that first contact, so you know, we're always incredibly grateful. That's why I'm here today, Bob, because there is a long standing loyalty here. I was told a million times of all the troubles in my way. Might you grow a little wiser, a little better every day? Saw my face in any window, any day. Now they say your books are telling you be a superstar, but I tell you just be satisfied and stay right where you are.
Keep yourself alive.
Yeah.
Keep yourself alive.
Ooh. Take you all your time and the money, only if you survive.
Just one final thought, because, you know, a lot of the work that we were doing together, documentary filming, interviews that we were filming, lots of stuff that we were compiling between us, Brian, at that time. hadn't seen the light of day, had it until just recently.
That's
and
right.
The Queen documentaries that have caused such a massive impact.
It's amazing.
It's incredible.
They really have, yes. And a lot of the footage of you interviewing us was brought out, and it was all covered in dust and scratches, yes. And the boys did rather a good job of restoring it to something that could be viewed. But, of course, the moment is very precious. You know, we're there and we're talking about things which I think all of us had forgotten about. So that was a very important ingredient to the documentary. We're very controlling people, as you probably know, but we, for once, we didn't put our big hands all over that. We gave... Reese and Simon put that documentary together really without us messing with them, and I think they did a wonderful job. They really did. It was a labour of love for them because they've been fans as well as professionals. But what a great job they did on the Queen documentaries.
Absolutely brilliant. Mm. So one final word about that Hammersmith Odeon concert, Brian. To
just, yes.
The performance that night of Bohemian Rhapsody. Because one of the aspects of bow rap that I thought was just fascinating was the piano, the different texture that the piano playing brought into that song.
Yes.
And it's, you know, I always thought this about, think this about Paul McCartney, for example, who plays, you know, bass, but then can walk across to the piano.
Yeah.
And by sitting down at the piano, bring an entirely different feel and sound. And of course that's what Freddie did, wasn't it? And
yeah.
And it was the most idiosyncratic way that he played the piano as well, hitting the top notes with his left hand while leaving his right where it was. So he sort of crossed over,
that's
didn't he,
right.
with his left to his...
He had a very individual style, and he had certain keys that he loved to play in, which were not the keys which are easy for guitar players. So that really was a big influence on me. So I learned to play in E-flat and A-flat and F and whatever, you know, which most guitarists really hate doing. But because that happened, it made me find different ways of doing things. So the way that the piano and my guitar blended together was an amazingly... How am I going to put this? It was an amazingly recognisable ingredient at the centre of a lot of the work we did. Mm. And Freddie was a great piano player. I would say that without hesitation. He didn't think he was. And as time went on, he played piano less and less, as you probably saw, and he would get other people in to play for him. But we loved the way he played piano. And if you listen to those old backing tracks... stripped away to things like Good Old Fashioned Lover Boy, Killer Queen, whatever, Play the Game. The way he played with Roger and John on those backing tracks is monumental. He's so percussive, so rhythmic as a piano player.
Mm.
And he's very exceptional, Freddie, in that department.
It's so lovely to see you. It always is,
thank you,
Brian. Thank you so much for being here. And we're just going to close with the final moments from Bohemian Rhapsody. Was a truly wonderful way to herald in Christmas. Queen at the Hammersmith Odeon, Christmas Eve, December 1975.